Number two, there's a lot of algorithms running on the cloud front to ensure that your content gets evicted if it's not used in a particular format or in a particular timeline. Number three, you also have content invalidation requests, where let's say you're totally changing a website at version 2.0, for example, right? Then you could invalidate your request based on a path parameter, ensuring that your content is not stale, right? It's basically a lot of those kind of things that you do, which is, I still feel beyond forum that we are in today, right? Okay, let's come back to the same chemistry discussion that we had. Right, this is how it was before. Now, with using cloud and AWS as your infrastructure and services solution, you could actually plan exactly for how much you need. Here, you would use an option called PSU. I mean, I haven't spoken about the cloud's tenets, right? The basic tenets of a cloud. What exactly does a cloud mean? The ANSI standards have actually defined cloud to have basically five tenets. I'm not able to recollect all of them, but some of them is pay as you go, broad network access, right? So which means that I should be able to provision my capacity on demand and also pay for it on demand. I do not have any. There are ways you can actually ensure that your costs are lower by going for pre-contracted rates and all that kind of stuff. We call it reserved instance on AWS, whereby you can actually control your cost much lower for known workloads. But then basically, if you look at the green lines, that's how easy for you to scale on your capacity and ensuring that you put your money right where it matters. Especially true for a lot of startups where you are really cash strapped, you are crunched for cash and money, you can actually put it right.
There's a very interesting news. Nobody else has the spot and bidding instances on the mutual which you are talking about, the costing and money.
So that's what I'm saying. So there is a lot of, pay as you go would probably be a basis of how you would like to understand cloud as. But cloud also, AWS also has a lot of approaches where you can actually ensure that you use the infrastructure right, especially in the EC2 space. EC2 is our virtual server environment, VMs as you call it. Right? Let me just complete and then I'll answer. Right? So you can reserve your instances and say, I know that my base load is this much, I want to reserve these. Then you actually get benefits out of it. Your cost could go down, beyond what you on-demand prices, right? And then he mentioned about spot instances. Spot instances are, it's almost like a spot market where you can actually go bid for a particular instance for a certain amount of time, and then make use of pay 1/10 of what it might actually cost in the real the pay-as-you-go model. Good use cases for, say, you are crunching large amount of data, you really don't care about losing a node every now and then, but you actually achieve a greater goal. For example, let's say you're sitting on a large amount of data which takes about 10 hours to do it because you have n number of capacity. What if I multiply that capacity by 10 times, add 10 times the capacity, pick up the instance of spot market or spot instance as we call it, get the work done in 1 hour, right? You might actually pay less and then get the work done faster as well. So that's basically what a spot instance is. I would like you guys to go read more about it. Not really required to be discussed here, but we have got your questions.
Yeah, so I noticed that we are directly jumping to the cloud. Do you think that we can have some discussion around how the cloud computing and what is cloud computing, how it works? Maybe it's good for some of us. Now we are moving right, so directly jumped into the cloud.
Sure, so.
I hope most of us.
Sure, I think so. What we are trying to do here is exactly that, right? I've tried to take you from from how, what you typically think about a capacity from an on-premises to a co-located data center to cloud, right? Essentially, if you look at it at the core, when you talk about cloud, that's basically what it is: compute, storage, and bandwidth. And these are three things. But that's not where it stops. In AWS, right, there are a lot of things that you keep doing repetitively, creating an instance for, say, database management. You want to set up a database management, a DBMS like, say, Oracle or MySQL, right? Many people don't know how to set that up. At least I don't know how to, set it up, right? I could use a managed service from AWS. So what AWS is doing is, it is also helping you to get away from reinventing the wheel every time you are doing a new project or embarking on a new idea or a new solution, right? So a lot of solutions are available out there in AWS, which I'll get to in a short bit. So this is my I usually use this caption a lot in forums like this, is that the very first line of code you write would add value to your hello world, nothing beyond that. Which means, if I want to write a hello world in that real sense, I want to set up a website which says hello world, raj.com and hello world, right? If I want to do that, I have to set up a server, I have to choose which OS, I have to install an OS on top of it, I have to patch it correctly, and then choose a particular say a server like an Apache web server or say a Tomcat container. I deploy that, and then I open up ports, right? And then I go write my two liner HTML page, right? To just put that two line file, I'm doing all this kind of work. Is it really worth my time? It is not. In AWS, you have this available out of the box for you, right? We call it platform as a service, Elastic Beanstalk. I just say I want a IIS environment. In couple of clicks, you can have that environment up and running. So you simply go put your file there, which means what you have done, that very first line of code you have written is your hello world. Nothing beyond that. Elastic Beanstalk actually helps you to do all this for you. Say I want a highly available environment, fault tolerant, and the Elastic Beanstalk will ensure that it adds all these policies for you and all that kind of stuff, so that you don't worry about the underlying infrastructure. Sorry, I'm not looking this side much. Ensure that I have eyes behind my head as well. Alright? Or make some noise so that I can look at this side. Alright, so that's basically what you get, right? So from on-prem co-located data centers to cloud, right? Cloud being available on demand, billable like a service, like a pay-as-you-go model. So it really changes. So when you're not using it, you shut it down, you don't pay anything for it. So what that gives you? Ability to fail fast. Everybody here has an idea that could be the next Airbnb of the world. And how many people know about Airbnb? Everybody knows about it. But there was some time nobody knew. And I heard a story which I heard a few of my colleagues used. One of the conferences where a lot of hotel folks were there, one of the presenters asked, "Do you know who your biggest competition is?" People named different kinds of chain hotels all over the world. But he said, "No, our biggest competitor today is Airbnb." Nobody knew about Airbnb. Right, so that's a very fairly fresh startup, but I think has more than 2 lakh bookings a day, and they run on AWS. Do you know how? So they have a fairly large usage of resources, AWS resources, right? Do you know how many people manage that infrastructure? Take a guess. Just give me a number.
Five people.
Five people. It's a published article. So five, hardly ever, roughly about five to six people is what manage the entire infrastructure, right? That's possible because of the tools available on AWS, right? So that really changes the way you do. So let's say if my solution like Airbnb was probably not a good idea, for example, right? Airbnb went through a lot of ups and downs, right? It's not a story, success story right from day one. Okay, I forgot the name of this company, but how many people know Angry Birds, the game? Thanks for that. Right, okay, a lot of people know about the company now because Angry Birds. But Angry Birds was their 52nd game that actually saw the light of day and was actually successful. Before that, they failed so many times, right? What really comes to you today is this ability to experiment, fail fast. You know, before, if somebody had a startup idea, they probably would just let it die because it's impossible to see the light of the day because, you know, it takes so much money to get it done. But today, that's changing. That's changed. You know, there's so much activity in startup activity in Hyderabad itself that I'm amazed because of the ability to do stuff faster on AWS. And if it doesn't work, you just shut down. You don't pay anything beyond that. You don't have to worry about, oh, where do I go sell this hardware, or maybe I should open a training center. I don't have to do all those kind of things anymore, right? So the ability to experiment more, if you have 10 ideas, you can actually do 10 parallel environments and actually see which one is more successful, right? It is also giving the enterprises, we also use a statement called enterprise strikes back, which means we are now able to provide the ability for enterprises to think lean. They are able to now, give the startups a run for their money, right? Because the scale, because of the agility and because of the tools we provide on AWS, right? So second thing that people usually talk about is security. What do you mean by security, right? This is actually a question somebody asked me when I went for a discussion. It's a pretty, mom and pop kind of a shop guy, pretty big as such, purely run by family members. He said, "Mera data tumhare server pe hai, cloud pe hai. What is the guarantee that it's safe, right? It's somewhere out there. I want to be able to look at it." He's a server hugger. I mean, he loves to argue to his servers. I don't know for what reason, but he actually has said that. I want to be able to go see your data. Dikhta to nahi hai data apne ko, but still, that is the kind of mindset people have. It is valid. It's their, it's their hard-earned, empire that they have set up, right? If they suddenly say, "Hey, I want to," you're putting your stuff out there. So security becomes the next most important thing people have to consider. In AWS, security is our number one priority as well. Okay? We do not release a feature, a service without having taken care of all the security features that it needs to, satisfy to ensure that there is a secure service offered to AWS. For example, right, when we are all developers here, we all know what an API means, right? You make an API call, and then you get response back. Every API call that you make to AWS has to go through HTTPS. Basically, it has to be encrypted over the wire, right? Every API call, while you might be, so when you go back, I think when you start downloading the SDKs, right? Every API call that you get sent across gets signed with the credentials and with the tool sets that we have built within the SDK, so that over the wire communication is always secure. That's the kind of security we're talking about, right? There are built-in controls for network security, right? When you talk about on-premises environment, we talk about DMZs, you talk about routers and all that kind of stuff, right? Security at different levels, right? You can envision your infrastructure exactly the way you think about in terms of on-premises, by looking at different controls, right? So every server that you create, every server that you create comes with all ports closed by default, except it gives you a suggestion saying if you're creating a a Linux box, it will try to say, do you want to keep port 22 open? And if it's a Windows box, the RDP port. And it gives you also a control as to whom you want to open this port for. There's a section on the right side. I'll show you as part of the demo how to do it, but you know, to whom this particular port you want to be open. That, do you want to be open it for this external facing endpoint or a finite set of IP address range called CIDRs, or you want to keep it to the entire world? The moment you keep it to the entire world, it actually gives you a warning saying you are trying to keep it to the open to the entire world, please review, right? So this is called instance level. This is basically the ports being closed at all at the instance level by default, unless you open them yourself.
What
you can even EC2 is basically elastic compute cloud. So basically elastic compute is basically your compute servers. Cloud is on the cloud. So elastic EC2. So we lovingly call it EC2. That's how it's known today, called EC2. Right. Yeah, thanks for asking that question. Good. So EC2 or a virtual machine on AWS is basically comes with all ports closed by default. You can even close the not have any ports open, inbound ports open on your servers. That's also a valid use case, and deploy the box, right? So the moment you create an account in your in AWS, you get a something called VPC. VPC stands for Virtual Private Cloud, which is basically your virtually demarcated environment where you can define public, private subnets. You define the entire technical stuff, typical stuff that you typically want to do, right? You have a DMZ for all internet facing workloads. You have a firewall in the middle. You can kind of set up all those kind of things on AWS virtually, right? So we have network access control list to control traffic between subnets, right? And I didn't mention about security groups. Apologies for that. So security group is basically an instance level firewall layer, which is basically tells you what you want to allow. I didn't mention about it. Yes. So which ports you want to allow from which which protocol, and then to which endpoints, like CIDR range or open to the entire source. And you have a load balancer and a web layer, which is typically your DMZ area where you let requests come in, right? On AWS this doesn't need to be in the public environment, right? You can, because this is taking care of all the requests. You can pretty much ensure that these don't have to be open to the entire world. You can just keep these open for these load balancers, and you pretty much are taking care of it, right? So what you would typically do is, I have a DP subnet, which I'm saying that I don't want to allow any traffic from my application layer or my web layer to the DP traffic directly. I want to only allow my app layer to be able to connect to my DP, right? And I won't only want to let my web and app talk to each other. So these are pretty common scenarios, and you can typically envision this, and you can set it up on AWS. Runeet will probably quickly show you guys how to do this as well, and how to set up a basic VPC. Okay. So you spoke a lot about AWS. How do you typically differentiate from on-premises to the cloud environments, right? There's a lot of information, there's a lot of documentation available out there on AWS. AWS also has its own AWS channel on YouTube, which gives you a lot of different levels of knowledge depending upon where you are. 101s are usually pretty high level, trying to explain the concepts. 201, 301, and those kind of series are much more deep dive. So depending upon your requirement, you would actually look at those information and go through it. And we also have a microsite called aws.amazon.com/architecture, which talks about different kinds of architectures that you might want to model on AWS. Sorry?
Maybe we'll be sharing these slides.
We'll try to get this.
I might have to edit it a little bit, but yeah. Right, so these are the, these are Microsoft where you could go and see so many architectures, reference architectures, already available for you to get that, up and running. Right, I'll come to manage this in a bit. But, so there are a couple of things that I wanted to also mention, right? How many people know the term DevOps? How many people do DevOps? I see one hand there. Awesome. You all are doing DevOps, but you just don't know it. Okay, see, DevOps is a term that's coined a few years back, but it's existed for a long time, right? If you are trying to do some kind of automation to make yourself productive, you're already in the path of DevOps. Okay, I remember I started coding from using notepads. Okay, every line I write, every two lines I write, I do Control C to actually compile my file to see if there are any errors or not. That's the kind of environment I actually built on. I slowly graduated to an IDE like NetBeans and Eclipse, made my life much more easier, right? So that's beyond it. What I'm saying is, DevOps is basically a process where you try to bring two enemies together, operations and development teams. All right, I use the term, it doesn't work in production, and the production guys come and tell what the hell did you do wrong. I typically say it works in my laptop, but the operations guy says no, it doesn't work on laptop. Right, so we are trying to by using DevOps processes, we are trying to reduce the gap between these two, so that we all work as one team. Right, if you look at it, operations teams can give a lot of information for you to build your application right, have high availability, scalability, how to think about being stateless. A lot of things come from them, which we probably don't think about to include them. We just build a particular tool and throw it across the wall, say, go figure out. Right? We also give a runbook to tell them how to deploy. We say, go to command line, do. Things need to change, right? We need to be able to much more agile in trying to, so DevOps is, in my opinion, this is my personal opinion, DevOps is basically anything that works seamlessly for you to get from development to production without having any problem. Right? What you do to get that working is all up to you. But today, a lot of focus is on trying to remove manual steps so that the migration or the progression from development to production becomes much more repetitive, and it's based on a few clicks. Like, for example, you use tools like, okay, how many people know about Hudson?
Jenkins.
I was coming to that, right? Jenkins is a more open source, I think Hudson was the precursor for Jenkins. Jenkins is pretty widely used tool. And I used it a lot to build a lot of DevOps processes in my entire life. And it basically helps you to automate builds, automate deployments as well. And it's got a lot of plugins where you can interact with different managed services, which includes AWS, right? And then, so there are a lot of commercially available tools as well. Anyone knows a commercially available tool?
TeamCity.
Travis.
Yep, awesome. Nolio, for example. But these all, of course, comes with a lot of cost involved. I'm saying they're probably awesome tools for what they provide. That's why customers are using it. But when you come to AWS, right, you also have a lot of tools available free of cost on AWS. And doing DevOps on AWS is literally free. Right from your console. To me, the console is DevOps ground zero. Which means right in sitting in front of your laptop, you can actually look at the entire world's infrastructure. You can actually deploy applications across the world. Right? That's ground zero for me. But then you can use tools like Beanstalk, a managed platform as a service for you, or use OpsWorks. It's a managed chef like environment that where you can actually have much more control. Like, so Beanstalk is more convenience, OpsWorks is more control and convenience built together, so you can actually manage layers, application layer, web layer, DB layer. Let's say you guys are itching for more, you want to control each and every bit of an infrastructure. We have a solution called CloudFormation. CloudFormation is infrastructure as code. That's where it completes the DevOps cycle, which means you can actually even you don't need to wait for the infrastructure team to set up a base infrastructure to start doing your coding, doing your automated deployments and all that stuff, right? You could write code even for infrastructure, which means you can version your infrastructure as well. So let's say you add something new. If you add it through the through this process, we can easily identify what went wrong, because you are now comparing infrastructure because it has code like a version control system, right? So that's, and then we have a lot of tools like services like code deploy, code pipeline, code commit to make your life much more easier. Of course, the code star services are not really entirely free. The way you use them makes them much more efficient, right? So that's basically what is it. We call it EC2 container service. Lightsail, let's say if there are individuals who do not really want an elaborate infrastructure, they just want one server with all built in, right? I can use a concept called Lightsail, where you pay as little as $5 a month to set up a server and run a simple website, so that I don't really see too much traffic, but I can do that, right? Then I have platform as a service. Let's say if you know exactly what you're trying to run, like like a Tomcat environment or IIS or Ruby, those kind of environments, where you don't want to really worry about building the whole stack up. So for example, Tomcat takes a WAR file, WAR file, right? You simply drop the WAR file there, it works. Or if it's a web service, just simply zip up the HTML static content, drop it there, starts working out of the box, right? It goes on. If I forget to mention about Lambda, please stop me and ask me what it is. Okay, I'll come to that.
Shadow apps.
The IoTs, they have. Yeah. We'll see if we can get to IoT assets, but yeah, we'll get to
it. Nobody else is providing.
Yeah. So the other thing is storage. Rudy's already mentioned about the EBS volumes and all that, which comes as part of the compute. But you also have additional storage options where you can choose depending upon your workload. Same databases, networking we already covered, migration services. A lot of customers ask, okay, I am sold on cloud. I want to go to cloud. But how do I go to cloud? That's a pretty big challenge in itself, right? Thanks a lot, Rinit. Have a great journey.
Thank you.
So how do I migrate to cloud, right? Do I move data first? Do I move apps first? Do I do A/B kind of? So that's a whole discussion by itself, right? So you have a lot of services available. Let's say you want to move data to cloud first. You use a service called DMS. If you are already on a virtual machine environments, on premises or co-located data centers or some other location, you want to move your applications to AWS. You have application server migration service available. So it helps you to convert or move VMDK files. If anybody knows VMware stuff, you move the VMware images to AWS and start using them without having to do stuff like that, right? It goes on, but that's just the beginning, right? A lot of tools that developers would typically use, right? Like for example, how many people use GitHub? GitHub is a default way of checking in your code so that you don't lose it. But still, GitHub is it's not in your environment. You want to be able to connect to your GitHub environment or an environment which is much more closer to you, controlled within that VPC that I spoke about, right? GitHub, AWS has got something called code commit, which is again built on top of GitHub. So all that was working for GitHub works seamlessly in code commit, right? And then several management tools makes your DevOps lifecycle very easy. AWS has something called CloudWatch. It is a centralized location for capturing logs of all your infrastructure with a dashboard built in. It doesn't cost money. right? The default logs that comes in 5 minutes range, that's all free of cost. It you you know it keeps the data or logs in memory or in you know usage for 12 up to 2 weeks, I guess, or 14 days, and that can be retained for longer as well. Similarly, cloud formation I just spoke about, infrastructure as a code environment. Cloud trail. A lot of folks would like to know what's happening in your environment, right? Because it's in the cloud, because multiple people can actually access your account. Somebody could go delete something. Cloud trail records each and every action that has happened on your environment, like lifecycle actions on a particular service. Somebody logged in, somebody deleted a file, somebody created an instance, removed an instance, added a port, all these things which go in to your IT auditor's report so that the IT auditors can do their job much better, right? So config tells about how my environment is changing from day to day. It's almost like an inventory, so that you don't go run all the scripts for yourself. That's available out there for you. Those are the kind of service. OpsWorks manage, I told you, a chef environment, right? Trusted Advisor, which tells you, see, every application to be well architected has to go through 4 basic parameters. How fault tolerant is your application? How well performing is your application? How secure it is, and how well you are architecting it for, from a cost and cost point of view. The 4 pillars on which a true architecture actually is relying on. Trusted Advisor gives you that report for you to just click on it. It gives you the report for you.
Could you
write
the 4 points?
For performance, fault tolerance, security, most important one, and cost, basically, using the right instances, using the right storage, all that kind of stuff, right? And then all the security stuff. So for example, you build an application. How many people actually do penetration tests on your websites?
Yes.
Yes, creating a new account.
Okay, what's happening?
So,
asking for payment. Yeah, okay. So, people who have, do you have AWS accounts already? I heard more than yes, which means most of you don't have. Please go ahead and create an AWS account. It will ask you for a credit card. It doesn't charge you money, it just will validate your credit card. Based on your request here today, who registered with your email addresses, I will try to get a few credits for you. I really cannot promise how much, but usually it's about $50 or something like that, so that you can just play around a little bit. But there are a lot of free tier services available already in AWS. Like EC2, if you use T2 Micro, you can run it for one entire month. So something like that. So there are a few free tier as well available. So be cautious when you use it, but yeah, you have to use your payment. You have to have an account created to be able to create this. So there's no way you can get away from that. So that's because you're paying as you go. For students, right? Depending upon if it's an event like this, we announce a few credits, a credit code which can use applied in your account. You suddenly have a bill or a value of $50 or whatever it is, right? If you are a startup, we have a program called Activate, which gives you a $500 credit to start with, and anybody could go register as long as you are registered as a startup. Then there are incubators. There are there are some incubators out there, like 91 Springboard, Sequoia. There's a lot of incubator / VC enabled organizations where you get more. Like T-Hub, for example, if you sign up with T-Hub, you get somewhere about $2,000 to $10,000 as credits to start off your use case. So different ways to get credits, right? So you can start off like that. Anyway, so you have so many services. Let's say you don't want to do core stuff. You want to be able to use I use services like artificial intelligence, you know, image recognition. You know, that's a very long topic by itself, but imagine the amount of energy, knowledge and technology you have to put in place to get an image recognition solution to work. While most of the use cases are pretty common, right? Recognizing an image, recognizing objects and all that. AWS has made it commoditized by providing a service like recognition, which is a simple API call. You just send it a blob or a location in S3 saying, please find all the objects in this image for me. I'll show that quickly if you have, you know, the demo now. Right, so that's basically how your services are segregated. Right? Did Rudit show you guys the EC2, how to create EC2? Yes, okay. So let's start with that quickly. If you don't have accounts, don't worry. Ideally, you should create an account and have a go at cracking it. If you do not have, create the account, don't worry about the cost right now. Because when I provide you credits, that they are applicable, prospectively, which means if you run $10 credit this thing today, if you apply the credit in the next couple of days or couple of weeks, before the month ends, that credit will be automatically applied to your billing. So it's as simple as that. So don't worry about it. Right, okay, so let me quickly.
I have a question on that.
Yeah.
So when I created one image and web service account, so initially it gave some amount to do that. So after pay as you go, right? It will pay as you go. Because I'm new to this account. If I do something, I may charge it. So I don't want that surprise. Either maybe I can put some limit.
Yeah, there's no limit as such. There's no monetary limit that you can put on your usage, but you can put an alert on your billing. Say the moment my billing crosses $10, I want to be notified, so that I can shut it down.
Yeah, I have a suggestion. I think it's good if you put, especially for newcomers,
mm-hmm.
we don't know everything about this. So we don't want, after burning the hands, you don't want alerts.
Yeah, so,
like,
okay.
It,
yeah, that's a good feedback, agree. And, eventually that might be there. No, I'm not sure, but yeah, it's a good feedback. Agree. Okay, so let me quickly show you how to set up an instance on AWS.
So, even to try on AWS, we need to burn someone.
No, so there's every service has a free tier. There's a little bit of free tier available for every service, which makes it easy to test your waters and then get out of it.
Okay.
Right? So
that free tier, is it based on monthly or is it?
Your billing is always monthly. So let me start with compute very quickly. I'll show you compute. So this is how a console, an EC2 dashboard looks like, right? In the right side, you have resources, which shows you how many running instances, how many running VMs you have, how many dedicated hosts you have. Dedicated host is again a concept around, some people don't want a virtual machine, which is basically a shared on underlying hardware. They want to be able to have access to a dedicated host. Then you can choose dedicated host as option. Let's not get to those kind of details. Volumes is nothing but the EBS volumes that Runit had mentioned. Key pairs is actually a way you actually log into the boxes and all that. Security groups also mentioned in the initial login. So let's launch an instance. Okay, another thing to keep in mind. I told you, right? You have the entire world available to you for deploying your architecture, right? Right from the default is US East, and then it keeps going. Within US, we have five data centers actually. Canada, EU, Asia Pacific, which also includes Mumbai, right? So I'll do one thing. I'll choose Mumbai. So be very careful where you create. What happens is, you will not pay attention there. Next time when you log in, it shows up a different region, just because you either have a VPN on or something like that. You'll say nothing is on there. You go create one more. So you have two regions actively running stuff. be careful about that. Okay, so it happened to me, so I'm just telling you. Okay, so this is how your EC2 dashboard looks like, right? So in AWS, we have something called an image. An image is nothing but an operating system version with whatever it actually gets bundled with. At AWS, we have Linux, primarily Linux, and Windows as the two operating systems available as images. So the first one that comes up is free of cost. I mean, it's a free one, community edition. Amazon has actually modified it to include Amazon's own tool sets, which is easily for you to start off with. You can also bring in your own AMIs. I said, right, when you use the migration service, either you convert your VMDK files through the service, or you can import your own images into AWS and then start using them. Right, so let's start with this one. Okay, so by default, it is selected T2 Micro. Just remember, please be very careful. This is very important. Even if you guys are sleeping, wake up, because this is the only one instance type which is available free of cost for 750 hours in a month, in 1 year. And then beyond that, you have to start paying for it. So, which means that you could run one instance for 750 hours, 10 instances for 75 hours, 100 instances for 7.5 hours. So it's actually the total count of number of hours you run. That's all, right? So be very careful. If you are trying, just try it with this, okay? So that's basically why it also says free tier eligible, okay?
So can we stop this when we are...
Yeah, when you stop it, you don't pay anything, okay? So ensure that you do not keep it running. If you are done with your work or learning, stop it. You will not lose your data because T2 Micro has EBS only set up. So how many people paid attention to instance storage when Ronit was talking? Okay, so we have two kinds of disk-based volumes. One is EBS, which is connected volumes. The other is ephemeral storage, which comes with the instance. The data you put in that instance store or ephemeral store will be lost when you stop the instance. But the data that is stored in the EBS volumes doesn't get lost. Okay, that's something to keep in mind. Okay, next I'll configure the instance details. Starts with number of instances you want to create.
For the server, how much the EBS space do you get?
You can add anything. By default, you get 8. For free tier, 30 GB is the maximum you can attach. But beyond that also you can go, then you will start paying money for the storage. Remember, there are three cost components in AWS. Compute, storage, bandwidth. Anything that you do on AWS, if it results in creating these three components, you will start paying for it. Of course, there are some higher end managed services which have a slight cost factor to it, but underneath security, the VPC, all that is free of cost, right? The VPC, subnets, and all this is free of cost. Okay, so instances. Another thing to remember in AWS is limits. Every service, when it is a SaaS kind of a service, right? It doesn't matter whether it's just infrastructure, like in AWS, it's a cloud infrastructure, or if you take a concept about, say, Salesforce. Every such service will have service limits. Reason why? So that you use them right, and you do not get charged for unnecessarily ignoring some aspect. So here, AWS gives you a default limit of 20 instances when you start the account. So if you say, you can actually say number of instances, by default it's 1, you can give 1 to many, but the limit is at 20. So that by mistake, if you instead of putting 20, if you put 200, you're done. And that's a risk. So AWS gives you the ability to put a soft limit on how you use the service. But if you're an enterprise, you can raise a request saying, hey, my requirement is 2000 instances. So it will open the limit for you, right? So So I'll quickly also show you quickly the instance types ones, right? So there are so many instance types available. Remember, in AWS, you cannot choose a combination of, I mean, you can always choose a fixed combination of cores and memory. It's not like you can say, I want 6 cores and 100 GB memory. You can't do that. So you, all those are already prefixed for you, and they are named accordingly. Like T2 are called burstable CPU instance types. M is basically a managed, balanced memory and CPU instances. Most common web services, websites can be run on that. C is basically compute intensive instance types. R is more memory oriented for memory oriented applications, and it goes on. X1 are pretty large instances with a RAM of 2 terabytes. Why would you need it?
In-memory databases.
Yeah, exactly. SAP HANA, for example. Right? That's, if the world is going towards in-memory databases, especially SAP HANA, requires such a large memory, and that's why you have those instances. It doesn't mean that you have to use only for in-memory databases. Let's say you're crunching a lot of data, right? Look at this. So that's the kind of, so that kind of different instances available, right? Oh, I didn't want to change that, sorry. So I want to keep my T2 micro. Let me just go back again. Be double sure, always, okay. So yeah, it is T2 micro. So let me configure the instance. I am going to do one, and one of my friends here talked about spot instances. If I say spot, it will try to pick me an instance from the spot section, which is much cheaper than what it is. The network information, which VPC you want to run, you can create maximum of 5 VPCs in an account per region. So there are 16 regions now, so you can have so many VPCs. Again, depends upon your workloads, right? Auto assign public IP. I don't want to waste too much time here. Role. So in the security part, let me just take one step back and talk a little bit of security, right? Security is a shared responsibility model everywhere. It doesn't matter what environment you look at. It applies to cloud as well, right? Which means, I was just talking to somebody here. I have a house which is most secure. Okay, it detects movement, it detects everything. Nobody can enter the house without getting noticed. So I lock the house and give my keys to my neighbor. How secure am I? While the house is secure, my security is only as good as the intentions of my neighbor. Right? I just know the neighbor because the person is my neighbor. So I'm just saying, just to put that analogy back here, right? AWS is secure from the way it has been built. AWS is taking care of all the components that require. I don't know. So I talked about AWS region being in Mumbai. I don't know where exactly Mumbai it is, because nobody is allowed to know that. Right? That's the kind of security. So there's a logical aspects of it. And then, if you I'd write at the beginning where if you don't know where the data centers are, you probably can never even get to physically to that environment, which is not the case with, say, co-located or on-prem data centers. I've actually seen organizations who actually display data center, which means it's an easy target for somebody who wants to do something malicious. But okay, so that's one thing. Right, so security is a shared responsibility model even on AWS, right? Which means AWS has taken care of the cloud with giving you all the those kind of features. But what you put on the cloud, it's your responsibility. You should ensure that you are architecting correctly, so that which we'll see now how do you do that. And if you don't do that, somebody will come and say, hey, my bill is increasing because networking is being invoked here. Networking is a data transfer. Whatever goes out will be built, and suddenly you will see a lot of bill charges to your account. So ensure that you do not open all the ports just like that. Nobody will know about me. Don't think that. There are bots running, which might keep on luckily, if they are lucky and you are unlucky, it'll get onto your systems, and then it'll start spawning stuff, and you'll be in trouble. Okay, so the other thing is IAM. IAM is basically Identity and Access Management on AWS, which basically creates users for you to manage. Because let's say you guys are all creating your accounts, right? It's a username, it's your email ID and a password that you give, and say you also enable multi-factor authentication. Let's say you are a startup, you have 2 people or 10 people managing your AWS account. You don't share the same username password. That's the very first irregularity there, right? So what you would do, you will use IAM in AWS, create groups and users, and tell what these users can do, and that's called a role, right? A role gets attached to a policy, basically, right? Roles are basically given to resources, right? Policies are attached to entities, including roles, where I can even assign that to a particular user and a group. So that's basically what IAM does. Okay, so I'll just leave it like this for now. Shutdown behavior start or terminate. When you stop the instance, you lose the instance completely. If you don't want to do that, you leave it as stop so that the instance stays there. The image also stays there. Okay. Next, add storage. Default, it shows 80. I can give up to 30 GB, which is free of cost. So I'll leave it at 8 for now. Right. Next, add tags. Tags are one of the easy ways to manage your infrastructure. Tagging is nothing but telling what this particular instance is about. Right. I'll just say add tag. And say name. Say I'm using this as a tag, so that next time when I do a tag based search, if I just simply give free code camp, it will come up. That's all, right? Now here is the security groups part. Now, security groups works like an object oriented model. Okay, everybody who's done programming knows what's object oriented programming, right? One of the use cases is reuse as well. Okay, so here security groups can be reused. You can reuse and attach to different instances, right? What you can do is, I can actually select an existing security group. I have a few here, or I can create a new one. For the sake of the demo, I will create a new one. Okay, so it says because it's a Linux box, it is saying, shall I keep the port 22 open? I can even close this. If I close it, nobody will ever be able to get into the box, including me. But I can come back and change this and get into the box. So a lot of customers do that. If it's a pure backend job, like a bad job or something nobody logs onto, I don't need to keep any port open. Let it run by itself. Right? So that's basically what. So it says protocol is type SSH. Protocol type is by default as TCP. If you want to control that, you could say custom TCP group.